GABA pathway and benzodiazepines. GABA is the main inhibitory neurochemical of the central nervous system. GABA is the main counterbalance for the excitatory neurochemical called glutamate. When someone is low in GABA, they have a difficult time dampening stimulation and will tend to be anxious and may even demonstrate seizures. GABA is basically the brakes on the nervous system. We will demonstrate this on a synapse. When an excitatory impulse comes down the originating nerve, as usual, the synapse has the opportunity to ramp up the impulse or decrease it. If GABA is released, the impulse is lessened. Benzodiazepines are thought to do two things as sedatives. They make the synapse more permeable to GABA, so there is a much greater inhibitory effect. They also diminish the amount of calcium that can flow into synaptic areas. Calcium assists in muscle contraction, and having less calcium involved is part of why benzodiazepines act as a muscle relaxant. And of course, over time, we experience downregulation. The receptors become less receptive to GABA, and therefore, it takes more and more of the drug to achieve the same effect. Then, when a person is coming off of the drug, they are getting less GABA, which will register as anxiety and typically gut issues. Additionally, the person coming off of will get an influx of calcium ions, which will likely trigger muscle contractions. This is the likely mechanism behind seizures when the withdrawal is too rapid. Some people get put on a benzo because of a challenging or traumatic life situation. When the situation in life has passed, they taper the drug, go through withdrawal to varying degrees, and then get through it. Other people seem to suffer indefinitely once the drug is discontinued and get into a situation often termed protracted withdrawal. There is some theory around damaged benzoreceptors and that the person is experiencing ongoing suffering as these receptors go through the process of repair. This is a plausible and viable theory. But we at Alternative to Meds pose another possible mechanism. That is the role of toxicity. Some toxins act as excitotoxins, as seen in the grasshopper video. These types of toxins dysregulate the neurochemical balance, and then a person can become symptomatic. A person who is poisoned generally presents with a reasonably constant type of anxiety that does not generally come and go. It is like a background roar in the nervous system. An analogy might be a game of catch. If a pitcher throws a soft pitch, a person can catch it with their bare hand. This would be analogous to a normal interaction within the nervous system. If the pitcher pitches a 100 mile per hour fastball, very soon you are going to need a glove. The 100-mile-per-hour fastball is an excitotoxic nervous system, and the glove is a benzodiazepine. If a person is excitotoxic, then tapering the drug is like thinning the glove. At some point, the fastballs are going to start hurting. Our approach is to get the pitcher to pitch a slower ball by removing the excitotoxic burden. We are also feeding the nervous system what it needs for receptor repair in the event of damaged receptors. This approach is working very successfully in our population. And we have helped many people with protracted withdrawal in a much shorter time. Unfortunately, for some that have been tapering at home for a long duration and are suffering unreasonably, the best recommendation is to go back up to a stabilizing level on the benzo. This is often a difficult conversation to have with someone. The rationale is that if the person is so debilitated and sleepless that they cannot engage in the program, then they are not going to be able to experience true relief, as they are going to be unable to address the toxic burden. A person who has lowered the benzo to the point of pain and physical distress is often where we find people. They are sort of painted into a corner. Once they raise back up to a stabilizing dose and engage in the program, they get the benefit of unburdening themselves of neurotoxic burden. And when it comes time to eliminate the meds, they can do it at a much faster rate with far fewer complications. We have tried a lot of methods, including the Ashton method, which involves converting to Valium as it is longer acting and is technically easier to taper from. We have found in most cases that it is better to taper off of the med that the person is accustomed to. Remember, it will be easier after the toxic burden is lowered. You want to spread out the dosing so that the person is not experiencing interdosing withdrawal. For instance, if a person is taking Ativan at night, since Ativan has a short half-life, they may experience withdrawal during the morning or day. It is best to spread the medication out two or more times a day to avoid interdosing withdrawal. By anyone's standard, even a slow taper off of a benzo can be difficult. Usually, the withdrawal from a benzo medication cut begins on or about the second day and may last until the third to fifth day. And it is typically accompanied by anxiety, fear, insomnia, and gut issues. If the acute withdrawal lasts longer than this, there is likely underlying neurotoxic poisoning that needs to be cleared up. There is a bridge medication that is considered safe: gabapentin. Basically, gabapentin is the naturally occurring GABA attached to a pentane molecule. It is basically a prescription vitamin and is definitely a lesser evil than a benzo. Gabapentin does not use liver enzymes to be broken down, which means the body is not registering it as a toxin. It can give the person just enough of a buffer to endure the benzo withdrawal. Once the person withdraws from the benzo, the gabapentin can be tapered much, much easier. Gabapentin has a very short half-life in the body and needs to be taken throughout the day to support the withdrawal. Since it has such a short half-life, gabapentin is not effective at giving someone a full night's sleep. For sleep, a person may consider Vistaril, which is an antihistamine, or trazodone, which is an older tricyclic antidepressant. These meds are just for the purpose of softening the withdrawal and are lifted once the withdrawal is complete. The bridge medications are optional. A non-prescription activated GABA product that is effectually similar to gabapentin is called phenotropic, also called phenibute. It is used in a similar way as gabapentin. GABA pathway and benzodiazepines. Supplements. Phenotropic 3 times per day. Taurine 500 to 1000 milligrams AM and PM. Tryptophan 500 to 1500 milligrams AM and PM. 100 milligrams of niacin, 200 milligrams theanine, AM and PM. Toxic impairment. Clear up neurotoxins, specifically pesticide and insecticides. Avoid diet sodas, aspartame, and any stimulants. Mercury can also often be implicated in these cases, as can other toxic metals. Diet. Eat organic where possible. Consider a microbiome cleanse and bone broth if benzo belly is present. Environment. Increase physical activity, specifically walking in a relaxed area. Try not to make big life decisions. During this time, a person is probably in fight or flight, and this will taint their perspective on life. We have successfully handled many 20-plus year benzo cases, and it has been a rewarding but often challenging journey. You can get through this. You just have to be strategic and go at your own pace and not take your current thoughts too seriously. They will pass. Consider bridging with gabapentin. When done correctly, this may be just the tool to round off the edge of this withdrawal and make it tolerable. Rapid detox for benzodiazepines is lunacy. We have unfortunately stopped working with folks who have just exited a rapid detox. It is not necessary to throw someone into crisis under the pretense that they are an addict. People coming into the center in that sort of crisis are basically unmanageable. We would much rather take someone on a stabilized medication level and do the tapering ourselves, as we will support them at a pace that they can handle.